Hello, welcome to this technical tea break. My name is Karina Monicu and I'm going to talk about fluorescence. In this technical tea break, we are going to learn about what is fluorescence, what are the absorption emission spectra of fluorescence molecules, why is fluorescence so important in bioimaging research, what is the dichroic mirror and fluorescence filter sets used in fluorescence microscopy? And what is the fluorescence microscope design, which uses reflected light? So if you have had the chance to use fluorescence microscopy, I'm sure you have been looking at amazing pictures in the micro world of biological samples. So what is fluorescence? Well, fluorescence is the emission of light by a molecule that has absorbed light. And as you can see here in this video, I'm using blue excitation light. And when I put a fluorescent sample, which is fluorescent beads, they emit green light. So the fluorescence, the emission of light, is from a different wavelength compared to the wavelengths of light that were used to excite the molecules. So if we look at these processes at the molecular level, we can see that so electrons can rest in the what is so-called ground state, resting state of the molecule. And upon irradiation of light, which will have a certain energy, a certain frequency and wavelength, in this case 400 nanometers in the blue, this electron can move to the higher level, to the excited state of the molecule. And this is quite quick. It happens in the femtosecond timescale. But the electron that stays in this high excited state is quite unstable and quickly loses energy and decays to the lower level of the excited state, and then returns to the ground state, resting state, with emission of a photon of light. So this photon of light, which is the fluorescence, so this emitted light fluorescence, has lower energy than the absorbed light because there was some loss of energy in the process and therefore usually has a longer wavelength. And this is a quite quick process, is in the nanosecond time scale, which is so-called the lifetime of the fluorophore. So this process is not 100% efficient. So not all the photons that get absorbed by the molecule result in an emission of fluorescence. And the efficiency of this process can be characterized by the quantum yield of the fluorophore, which is the number of emitted photons to the number of absorbed photons. So the whole picture happening can be described in Jablonski diagrams after the Polish scientist Jablonski. I'm not going to talk into details because interest of time, but what I want to point out here is that there are several levels of energy that and therefore several different wavelengths that the molecule can absorb and emit. And this is why we refer to fluorescent molecules. They will have their specific spectra, which is the absorption spectra and the emission spectra, which relates to all the range of wavelength that they can absorb and emit. And in this case, we are looking at the characteristic fluorescence spectra of fluorescein, FIT-C. So each of the spectrum will have their own maxima, and the differences between the two is considered, is called the Stokes shift, because it was first described by Sir Stokes. So why do we use fluorescence? Well, it's quite intuitive. If you want to look at the sky, you better go to the middle of the countryside. You, in the middle of the city, you'll not see as well, for example, the Andromeda galaxy or Cassiopeia constellation. You need to go to the middle of the countryside where you have much less background in the sky, much less light, so then you can see very nicely the stars. And this is because we can have much better contrast. So fluorescence images have a very good contrast. because there is a high signal compared to lower background, and therefore we can see quite well our structures compared to, for example, bright field images, as we can see here on the left. And the fluorescence is a relatively weak signal, and it's much easier to see a weak signal in a dark background than in a very bright background. So for example, if we compare the same sample in bright field image and in fluorescence, we can see that we get much better contrast under fluorescence. And that is not all. We can also do selective labeling, which means that we can selectively label different structures in your sample and look at them at the same time, which is, that's what it stands for, multiplexing, because we can exploit different colors along the visible spectrum and specifically label different fluorophores to different structures. And also we can retrieve quantification, meaningful data with some care, of course, and control, loads of controls, but this is possible and can be very useful in bioimaging research. And as important as well, we can look at live dynamics. Because fluorescence is a relatively low invasive technique, so for example, here we are looking at the dynamics of mitochondria over 3 hours of time. So we can look at the processes at the molecular level that are happening in real time. And this is really a great tool. So there are several probes that we can use for fluorescence microscopy. And for example, we can use genetically encoded fluorescent proteins, which will be co-expressed with our protein of interest, or we can use organic dyes that will chemically bound to the probe of interest. There are also inorganic dyes that are quite stable, although a bit big, like for example, quantum dots. And we can also look at endogenous species. So we will not tag or add an external fluorophore in this case because they naturally can emit fluorescence. So now I invite you to have a break, probably a sip from your tea, and even stop the video if you want and think about this question. Why is the background black in a fluorescent image? Well, the background is black in a fluorescent image because the illumination light, the light that is used to excite our probes, will be discarded from the detector. So the final image does not have any of that incoming light, and we are just looking at the fluorescence. So basically, we need a way to separate the two light paths, the excitation from the emission. And that comes now to the fundamental problem that all the fluorescent microscopes need to deal with, which is a strong illumination compared to a weak fluorescent signal. Because a fluorescent signal is quite weak, there are lower orders of magnitude compared to the illumination. And so how do we solve this problem? Well, we want to produce a high efficient illumination of the specimen as good as possible to try to increase the chances of this process to occur. And at the same time, capture the weak fluorescence emission coming from our probes. And we can only do that if we indeed separate the two light paths, the illumination or excitation light path from the fluorescence, which is the emission light path. And that is done with a dichroic mirror. So the dichroic mirror is really important because it's the one that separates these two light paths. And that is done because the dichroic mirror has several coatings, special optical coatings, that will be reflecting some wavelengths and letting pass through other wavelengths. And this happens with the interference, like destructive or constructive interference. So that's why the dichroic mirror is at the heart of fluorescence microscopy. So where does the dichroic mirror sit in our microscope? So for example, here we are depicting an inverted microscope because we are looking at our sample from below. So we have our sample of interest, the objective lens that sits underneath, and the dichroic mirror sits at 45 degrees underneath the objective. And therefore, dichroic mirror will be able to reflect the wavelengths of light that we are going to use to excite our sample, which then the objective collects the fluorescence, and the dichroic mirror lets these wavelengths to pass through just the fluorescence and discards the illumination wavelengths to the detector. But also in combination, the dichroic mirror is used in combination with the filter sets. So with the excitation filter and the emission filter, which will sit in the two optical paths. And the excitation filter will select just the wavelengths of the light used to excite our probe, and the emission filter the same to select just the fluorescence. So how does this look like if we combine all together our fluorescence spectra from the dye, for example, here still the FITC with filter sets and dichroic. So for example, here again, we have our absorption spectra in blue, the green, the fluorescence, and the dichroic ideally sits in between, which will be able to reflect all these lower wavelengths, and then has a very sharp cutoff to then let the fluorescence pass through the detector. And then ideally, like our excitation and emission filter sets will sit to take as much as possible from the two peaks of the spectra. And usually this combination of filter sets sit in a cube like that, which we can rotate either manually or automatically to separate the different channels. Although this is quite a slow process. So actually, when we are nowadays in modern microscopes to do multiplexing, and therefore look at different channels at the same time, we use what is so-called polychroics, which do exactly the same, but in opposed to just two sets of wavelengths, they do it in multiple wavelengths. So for example, something like that, we can excite these four fluorophores at the same time. And therefore, then the filter, the emission and the excitation filters will sit in these wheels that rotate much faster compared to the slower cubes that I showed before. So how does this look like in the microscope? So again, we have our polychroic, which will be the same for all the different channels, reflecting our illumination light and let the emission of the fluorescence pass through the detector. And therefore, we have this very fast filter wheel that can accommodate the different excitation and emission filters. And therefore, since they rotate, then we can simply select the different filter sets to excite different dyes along the spectra, and therefore doing our multicolor imaging. Now, I would like to point out another thing that I feel that very often gets confused, which is when we look at the microscope, which components are exactly used for the fluorescence opposed to, for example, the bright field imaging. So for example, here again, we have the inverted microscope where we have the sample that will sit here and the objectives from underneath. And therefore our light, for example, come like this, will reflect it from the dichroic to excite our sample. And then the fluorescence gets through either the camera or the ocular. Whereas the bright field uses these components over here, which is the condenser, and the light source will be here. So if now we look at this animation, you see that you could, for fluorescence, you can totally live with this part, with the condenser. And therefore, we can just use, we just need the part, the light part that sits underneath. And then another thing that usually gets people get confused is that fluorescence actually, it's emitted everywhere from our sample. But because of this geometry of separating the excitation from the emission light path, we collect the light from that gets to the objective, just a sub part of it, not the whole emitted fluorescence, but just a part of it, that the one that object people can collect. So overall, this process is quite inefficient in a way. So that's why it's super important to really work on the staining of your samples, to optimize the staining of your sample, and also to optimize to always match the dyes you are using to the correct filter sets you have in your microscope. So there are several techniques that nowadays are very commonly used. You might have or not heard about them, but what I want to say here is that all of them rely and use fluorescence. And by understanding these basic concepts that we covered today in this technical tea break, you will learn and understand them much better. And so this is it. I hope you enjoyed this technical tea break on fluorescence. Here there are some resources that you might find useful if you want to learn more. Please get in touch if you have any comments or questions. And thank you very much.